As usual, we will start with a prayer. Today's lecture is unconventional. Before I start the lecture, I would like to give you my contact platforms. The reason being that many times after the lecture or any academic interaction, people want to ask questions. The attendees want to reach out. They want to know more. In such a situation, you can contact me on these four platforms. And I promise you, I reply each and every query. If I don't know, I will always tell that I will read up and let you know. I may ask for more time, but I will surely reply. I want to ask you, are you interested? Interested in what? Scientists have discovered a revolutionary new treatment that makes you live longer. It enhances your memory, makes you look creative, makes you more creative, and it makes you look more attractive. So much profitable. Are you interested? I would further ask, this treatment protects you from cancer and dementia. It wards off cold and flu. It also lowers your risk of heart attack and stroke, not to mention diabetes. Are you interested in that treatment? And I'm not talking out of the hat. The evidence supporting this treatment is supported by 17,000 well-scrutinized research papers till date. Are you interested? That treatment is our simple, humble sleep. Surprised? Well, I want to surprise you more. Throughout this lecture, there will be many places where you'll be surprised. And I intend to do that. That is the plan. Therefore, the topic for this afternoon is the obstetrician and sleep. Do you know that this year, from 1st of Jan 2021 till 30th of June 2021, 13,476 papers have been published only on sleep and are indexed in PubMed. This comes to 2,000 papers a month and nearly 65 papers a day. This does not clash with the data which I said previously about 17,000 well-researched papers. That is only regarding the effects of sleep, the advantages of sleep. Here, this covers everything. And do you know that amongst all the specialties in medicine, obstetricians sleep one of the least amongst all professionals in the world? Surprise, no? Okay, now think. Think. Go to your sleeps, say of last 10 days, 15 days. Do you think you got enough sleep in the last week or last fortnight? No. Can you recall the last time you woke up without an alarm clock, feeling refreshed, not needing caffeine to stimulate you up? You don't remember, right? If the answer to either of these questions is no, don't worry. You are not alone. Two-thirds of adults throughout all developed nations fail to obtain their recommended 8 hours of nightly sleep. So much so that World Health Organization has now declared a sleep loss epidemic throughout industrialized nations. And India is very quickly catching up. Now be surprised. There is no human who has a sleep requirement of less than 6.5 to 7 hours. If someone claims so, oh, I have seen many people telling, oh, my sleep requirement is very less. I just don't need sleep. I don't speak a single word. I just smile within. If someone claims so, he or she is talking nonsense. You as a Homo sapien is not programmed to sleep for less than 6.5 to 7 hours. There is a rare genetic disorder in which such low requirements exist. But as I always used to teach, if you think of rare things, you are rarely correct. So, accept that your requirement is 6.5 to 7 hours at least. If you do not get this much as an obstetrician, you are quite likely not to get it, then there are risks. And what are the risks? The first risk is you tend to acclimate. With chronic sleep restriction over months or years, an individual will actually acclimate to their impaired performance, lower alertness, and reduced energy levels. That low levels of exhaustion becomes their accepted norm or baseline. Then they say that my requirement is less. No, sir, or no, ma'am. You have acclimated. Actually, your sleep requirement is 6.5 to 7 hours at least. And if you are not sleeping that, it is not that your requirement is less, but your body is bearing the brunt. And what brunt? You are becoming more susceptible to Alzheimer's and cancers. Routinely sleeping less than 6 hours or 7 hours at night demolishes your immune system, more than doubling of your risk for cancer. Insufficient sleep is a key lifestyle factor determining whether or not you will develop Alzheimer's disease. We are aware of at least two American presidents, past presidents, of course, who suffered from Alzheimer's. And for these politicians, as is common in India also, they acclimate so much that they boast that I sleep for only 4 hours. And we know the results. Your body has countless James Bonds. These are NK cells. NK cells for obstetricians are not any new entity. You know them. You discussed them when you discussed recurrent pregnancy loss. There, we are not considering them anymore. But for sleep, they have an important role. NK cells punch a hole in the outer surface of cancer cells in your body and inject a protein that destroys malignancy. What you want, therefore, is a vibrant set of these James Bond-like immune cells which are shooting the outer surface of cancer cells and destroying them. These are precisely what you lose when you are sleeping too little. This picture, possible. This gentleman might be an obstetrician and he has this consequence. Inadequate sleep, even moderate reductions for just 1 week, can disrupt blood sugar levels profoundly and precipitate heart failure. Perhaps you have also noticed a desire to eat more when you are tired. This is no coincidence. I remember after night duties, I used to feel hungry. And as a result, when I became senior, I always used to organize in such a way that my junior residents, after their duty, get adequate breakfast. Our schedules used to be very rough because we had a very peculiar emergency system, a weekly emergency system. But I always used to see that the junior residents who are on night duty, or all residents who are on night duty, they have not to attend the rounds. They go, take a bath, have breakfast, and come. Now I have the explanation. Because I could not take away their duties. I'm coming to that a little later. Too little sleep, now I know, increases concentrations of a hormone in your body that makes you feel hungry, while suppressing a companion hormone that otherwise signals food satisfaction. So you go on feeling continuously hungry. And as a result, you eat more and you gain more weight. As obstetricians and gynecologists, you want to know its effects on human reproduction. Understand it. A research group at the University of Chicago recruited a group of lean, healthy young males in their mid-20s and limited them to 5 hours of sleep for 1 week. Only 1 week. And their testosterone levels blunted. And how much did they blunt? This blunting was so large that it effectively aged a man by 10 to 15 years in terms of testosterone. So what was expected of a gentleman of 26 years, his blood testosterone levels actually were teetering around blood testosterones of 40 to 41 years of age when the sleep was inadequate. Men who report sleeping too little have 29% lower sperm counts than those obtaining a full sleep. What about females? Routinely sleeping less than 6 hours at night results in a 20% drop in FSH levels. In a report from more than 100,000 employed women, that comes to 1 lakh. In India, we use the word lakhs. Working at nighttime, resulting in poor quality sleep, such as nurses, had a 33% higher rate of abnormal menstruation than those working regular daytime hours. Faces pictured after one night of short sleep were rated as looking more fatigued. Zombie-like is the word in modern parlance. Less healthy and significantly less attractive compared with the appealing image of the same individual after they had slept a full 8 hours. I remember in one interview a very famous beauty queen who subsequently joined Bollywood as an actor said that whenever I have a shooting, I sleep early so that I can sleep at least 8 hours. And we know now why this happened. Her looks matter and they get affected if she has slept inadequately. It will affect you as well. I am today discussing only physiology of sleep. I am not a sleep consultant or a sleep derangement consultant. No, I don't discuss pathology of sleep. There are consultants for that. There are different types of sleep disorders and I would not like to go into it. This is physiology which we are discussing, bringing to focus today, so that you all can go back to sleep and enjoy a healthy life. And so, now let us see what makes us sleep. The thalamus has a very important role to play. The thalamus decides which sensory signals are allowed through its gate and which are not. We have 5 senses and they are sending continuously signals, eyes, ears, nose, touch, continuously. When you are awake, thalamus allows them to pass and go to the higher centers. Should they get privileged passage, which when you are awake, they get through, they are sent up to the cortex at the top of your brain where they are consciously perceived when you are awake. But then, this gate shuts, and that is shut by the thalamus. Thalamus imposes a sensory blackout in the brain. Now you are no longer feeling aware of the signals which are coming from your senses. Your brain has now lost waking contact with the world. Said in another way, you are now asleep. This is the physiology. And there is an interesting chemistry as well. In simplistic terms, melatonin is the key hormone that makes you sleepy. It takes you close to sleep, but does not put you to sleep. Adenosine is the agent which actually puts you to sleep. What is the importance? I will let you know. Its importance lies in stimulants like caffeine. When you take coffee, you feel sleepy, but you don't get sleep. Because agents like caffeine, they competitively inhibit adenosine, but they don't compete with melatonin. So melatonin makes you feel sleepy, but you actually don't fall off to sleep. And that is what caffeine and tea and all this they do. Now I am going to surprise you by a very fascinating physiological phenomena. Only one I will discuss, not all, which happens in sleep. And it will fascinate you as well, I'm sure. And that is neural sanitization, not sensitization, sanitization. And sanitization is taking place throughout your body. They say in the first part of your sleep, your body gets cleaned off its metabolites. In the second part of your sleep, the regeneration takes place. So suppose you are going to sleep, or you sleep for 6.5 to 7 hours. In the first 3.5 hours, the cleaning up takes place. And then the second 3.5 hours, the regeneration takes place. Though this is not a paper tight compartment, but there's quite a considerable overlap. But for understanding, you can think it this way. So if you are going to sleep only for 3.5 hours and boast about it, my dear friend, your body is only cleaning you off the catabolites. Your regeneration process is defective. It is during sleep that this neural sanitization kicks up into high gear. Associated with the pulsing rhythm of deep NREM sleep comes a 10 to 20 fold increase in effluent expulsion from the brain. When you are in NREM sleep, this expulsion of effluents takes place. And that is why this famous sleep physiologist explained why the CSF is so effective in flushing out metabolic debris at night. CSF circulation becomes speeded up and they flush it out. The glial cells of your brain actually shrink by up to 60% during the NREM sleep, enlarging the space around the neurons and allowing the CSF fluid to clean out of the metabolites. Actually, your glial cells become like this from this. Interesting. So imagine, to understand this, what happens is, say, imagine your city. Your city, mine, say, being Baroda or Vadodara, or the current host city, Bhagalpur, it shrinks at night by 60%. All the houses, all the gardens, all the roads, everything shrinks by 60%. And the cleaning staff or cleaning workforce takes water jets, and cleans everything up. And when you get up, it regains its original form. And what you get in the morning is a clean, shining city, or clean, shining your central nervous system. Fascinating, isn't it? You are sleeping, you don't even know that your glial cells have shrunk by 60%. And when you get up, they are back. Now I am going to explode a myth. I have no intention of paining anybody. I am sticking to physiology. And this I am touching intrauterine sleep and myths. Many times we find this through speech or song. We expect parents, the expecting parents often thrill at their ability to elicit small kicks and movements from their in utero child. Though you should never tell them this because it will dishearten them. The baby most of the times is asleep. Hardly during intrauterine life, more towards the term, the baby wakes up for about an hour or so, all throughout in 24 hours, and that too patchily, 5 minutes, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 1 minute here and there. Prior to birth, the human infant spends almost all of its time in a sleep-like state, which resembles the REM sleep state of the adults. The sleeping fetus is therefore unaware of the parents' dramatic performances and sermons, including probably the famous garbha gnan or garbha sanskar. The child is not listening. It is fast asleep. And you think that the child actually is listening. Because in mythology, that is a very, very powerful example of Abhimanyu and Lord Krishna. But as soon as you start discussing them or bringing them into your perspective, you are making a very big mistake. They were gods. Abhimanyu was a god, was a superhuman. And his god was God incarnate himself. Please, let us not bring normal physiology and normal laws and rules for them. You are making a big mistake. Actually, the kick which you feel of the child, and that was shown in the film Three Idiots. A kick mara, kick mara, kick mara. All is well, all is well. You say all is well at the child kicks. It's good in films on the screen for dramatization. But understand this, that a child is fast asleep, wo kick nahi mara. Any co-occurring arm or leg flip or leg bop that the mother feels from her baby are most likely to be the consequence of random burst of brain activity that typify REM sleep. It actually occurs in you and me also. But in utero, the immature fetus's brain is yet to construct an REM sleep muscle inhibiting system, which you and me as adults have. Therefore, we inhibit it. If you do not inhibit, you will also feel it. And you actually feel it. You feel that sudden kick when you are about sometimes to fall asleep and suddenly you feel your leg has moved. That is the time when your muscle inhibiting system has gone off and the block comes in and you feel. And then soon you drift to sleep. You are not continuously feeling it, the baby feels it. And that is because your inhibiting system are matured and grown up. It is only when in the final trimester that the baby is a little awake, in patchily. Therefore, the baby most of the times is not listening. You are wasting your efforts and wasting your money on. I'm now going to introduce you to something uncomfortable. It might scratch your conscience. So be it. Sleep and healthcare. We doctors work long consecutive hours. And we have made doctors work long and consecutive hours most many a times unnecessary. And no one works more so than doctor during their resident training years. Remember this word residency. Few people, however, know why. I also used to ask, why is this structure like this? Why are we continuously being forced to learn our profession in this exhausting, sleepless way? Why are we not allowed to sleep? Don't we know the physiology of human body? But our teachers were also helpless who constructed this, because the origin of this is in 1889, historic. It originates with the esteemed physician William Stuart Halsted. Halsted founded the surgical training program at the famous John Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore, Maryland in May 1889. And that is where the term residency came in, because Halsted's belief was that the doctors must live in the hospital for much of their training, allowing them to be truly committed. If they live at home more, they will not be committed. And when key opinion leaders at a critical point in history start thinking such things, the entire system goes haywire for generations together. Fledgling residents have to suffer and continue to suffer long consecutive work shifts day and night. Halsted, nobody could argue with, because he appeared to be like a superhuman. His mentality was difficult to argue. He himself practiced what he preached. He had a superhuman ability to stay awake for apparently days on end without any fatigue. And typically, like seniors and doctors and teachers, they will say, oh, I am awake for last 36 hours and you want sleep? So people couldn't argue. But then there was a deep, dirty secret. And that secret came to know after he died. Halsted was a cocaine addict, and therefore he was remaining awake. You and me are not. And what is the result? It affects our statistics. Data. Always look at the data. It will tell you the truth. The data is very scary. Residents working a 30-hour straight shift will commit 36% serious medical errors, such as prescribing the wrong dose of a drug or leaving behind a surgical instrument. Throughout their residency, 1 in 5 medical residents will make a sleepless-related medical error that causes significant liable harm to a patient. A word about sedation, and we will finish. There are 3 solutions to get deep sleep. One is pillow, strike the pillow, go to sleep. Other is pillow, and third is pillow. Choice is purely yours. Any day, I prefer the first. Let me tell you about a word about sedation and sleep. Scientists have started lobbying doctors to start prescribing sleep. It was somewhere around 5-7 years before that I first prescribed sleep. Before that, I had read about sleep. I had read a lot. And this incident, I remember. This case, I remember. This lady in question used to visit us for urinary tract infection nearly every 3 to 4 months. She used to come, used to prescribe. Invariably, she had pus cells in the urine. We treated her husband, we treated all possible causes, got all investigations done. Still, every 3 or 4 months, she would come. One day, I asked her, Beta, how many hours do you sleep? And she said, she was surprised at the first time, when I asked her the first time. a little taken aback. He said, sir, hardly 3 to 4 hours. I said, why so? He said that, sir, I have no problem in falling off to sleep. But in the morning at somewhere around 5, my husband gets up for his workout, because that is his routine. And when he gets up at 5 in the morning, he puts 3 alarms in the bedroom. If he can't get up with one, the second wakes him up. And if the second fails, he is woken up by the third. Now, of course, he snoozes, but it rings for sure. And he has to at least snooze twice, getting up at the third alarm. I told him, beta, I prescribe, besides your treatment, I prescribe sleep. Please try to fall off to sleep and sleep continuously till you wake up without an alarm. For 1.5 to 2 years, she was just not seen. Then after 2 years, she appeared once again. And this time she didn't come for herself. She came for her sister-in-law, who was pregnant and needed antenatal care. I asked her, how are you? Oh, sir, I'm fine. No infection, no burning. I said, how did that miracle occur? He said, sir, now I have found out an alarm clock, an alarm, a wrist alarm, which my husband now ties on his wrist, and his wrist feels vibrations. So he gets up without disturbing me and I sleep. This made me very sensitive and alert to this aspect. So now I prescribe sleep, and many scientists and doctors are lobbying for it. I'm not talking of sleeping pills. Prescribe sleep. Sedatives sedate you, please. They do not put you to sleep. What is the difference? We talked about thalamus. Thalamus is not knocked off. Thalamus doesn't close the gate. Dumb. No. That is not what the thalamus does here in sedation. It knocks out the higher regions. So the sensations continue, but you don't perceive them. That is not physiology. And as a result, these blunting impulses from the higher centers do not close the thalamic gate. So they sedate you rather than assisting you in sleep. And let me assure you, the quality of sleep is surely different. After sedation, you feel groggy, and after regular sleep, you feel refreshed. The last part, sleep solutions. Just 5-7 slides more. The sleep solutions need not be complicated. Some are simple and inexpensive, and the benefits should be immediate. What makes you make friends with sleep? Sorry. Observe what makes you fall asleep. Do it. Observe what shatters your sleep. Avoid it. Be ruthless in that. Don't fight with sleep. Do corrections. I must sleep at 9. No, not necessary. When does your body require sleep? 1 o'clock. Fine. You drift off at 1, get up at 8. Develop your routine in that way. Slowly, by trial, they say you can shift the sleep cycle. If your work demands that you should be at work at 8, you can shift it slowly, slowly, but don't fight with it. It will be possible. Another very important extraneous factor, these are internal factors, is temperature control. It has been found that many sleep disruptions have too cold or too warm temperatures responsible. Temperature fluctuations also disrupt many sleeps. You can control your room temperatures now easily and see how well you sleep. In the ACs, you have timers. Control it. also electric light. Your light is the villain. The way it strikes, this blue light, even in this room, what the video you are seeing right now, this recording, has a blue light. It is not sleep friendly. The old yellow light was sleep friendly. Many of us suffer from overexposure to nighttime light, particularly blue dominant LED light from our digital devices. This evening digital light suppresses melatonin and delays our sleeping time. However, now there are LED bulbs available with filters that can vary the wavelength of the light that they emit, ranging from warm yellow colors, less harmful to melatonin, to strong blue lights that powerfully suppresses it. It is there in your mobiles also. Program it in that way, your mobiles are automatically, it becomes yellow as the time, as per your time, and your sleep will not be disturbed when you are looking at the mobile and working before you sleep. Preferably avoid it. But if you can't, you have to work till you sleep, then fine, adjust the light of the mobile. That system is available. And such lights are now available even for the rooms. Come the morning, you can reverse the trick. You make the room light and your sleep will go away. This will help us wake you faster, more alert, and with a brighter mood morning after morning. Helps me. Gadgets, sleep tracking devices are available. They are affordable and they track an individual's sleep and circadian rhythm. Watch it. Which are your best hours of sleep? When have you slept the best? See that you are undisturbed in those times. Control everything extraneous at that time. It will help you to track sleep. Ladies and gentlemen, I always feel that sleep, like mother's love, is always taken for granted. We don't care. Sleep comes in the last priority. I know of godmen who are giving lectures that you are wasting your time sleeping so long. They are morons. They don't know anything of science. And they talk big, big things about pseudoscience. And they draw huge crowds. Don't listen to them. Whenever there are huge crowds, usually truth takes a beating. Therefore, I always compare sleep with mother's love. Always available, therefore always ignored. Stop ignoring sleep. Because the harms can be unimaginable. Best would be to fall in love with sleep. And the next half a minute will summarize the message of what will happen if you fall in love with your sleep. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.